Hi, Dan Alasso here with History for Today. And this is my second lecture or my second chapter in my modern world history. And this is one where we shift from Asia to Europe and Africa and look at the difference between really the Asian empires and the beginnings of the European nations. Now, this is actually a chapter that is sort of bracketed by two population disasters. Just before it begins in the 14th century, we have the Black Death sweeping through Europe, and it will end in the following chapter with the American depopulation of the Columbian Exchange, which we'll talk about next time. One of the major changes in Europe in the early modern period, which we tend to take a little bit for granted today, is the beginning of a tendency toward the building of nations rather than land empires. Although some European rulers, even later into this history, like Napoleon and then Queen Victoria, and then of course later Hitler, tried to expand the scale of their realms into empires. These were exceptions that kind of proved the rule. Victoria's British Empire, of course, was outside of Europe. And Napoleon and Hitler failed in their attempts to bring all of these nations together into another empire that emulated Rome. Europe's nations were identified by factors like ethnicity and language and customs and ultimately religion. Often these nations fought their neighbors over these self-identifications and identities. This made European nations unlike the empires of Asia and the Near East, which were typically very multicultural and multi-ethnic and multilingual, and included wide varieties of ethnicities and cultures within their borders. The first and the oldest and the largest empire, as we've seen, was China. But there were four additional empires that set the scene for the early modern period, and their histories helped to shape the world today. And these were the Mughal Empire in India, the Safavid Empire in Persia, which is now Iran, the Russian Empire on Europe's eastern border, and the Ottoman Empire in the eastern Mediterranean and the Middle East. And we'll begin with the Ottomans. They were a Muslim dynasty that rose initially on the borders of the Byzantine Empire in the 1300s. To become a world power when the Sultan Mehmed II, subsequently called Mehmed the Conqueror, overwhelmed the defenders of Constantinople in 1453. Constantinople had been the capital of the Eastern Roman Empire since the Emperor Constantine had moved his government there between 324 and 330 of the Common Era. It was an ancient city that was strategically very important because it controlled a strait called the Bosphorus that connects the Mediterranean Sea with the Black Sea. And this makes it the gateway between Europe and Asia. So it's a strategic choke point and very valuable. Mehmed took the city as his new capital and renamed it Istanbul. The Sultan actually allowed Christians and Jews to continue living in Istanbul, and he granted the Eastern Orthodox Church autonomy as long as they accepted Ottoman authority. But even so, many Christian refugees left the city and found their ways to cities like Venice and Florence, where they and their wealth and the books that they brought helped to ignite a period known as the Renaissance. Istanbul quickly became the largest Eurasian city outside of China. Under sultans like Suleiman the Magnificent, who reigned from 1520 to 1566, the Ottomans expanded into Europe. Suleiman nearly captured Vienna in 1529. They controlled shipping in the eastern Mediterranean and the trade routes and major markets connecting the Silk Road from China with centers of commerce like Cairo and Baghdad. The high cost of doing business in this Ottoman-controlled Middle East and the tax that the Ottomans took off of all of the commerce coming across the Silk Road from Asia was one of the major reasons that European merchants sought other ways of reaching Asia. The Ottomans were actually quite tolerant of ethnic and language and religious diversity, and their empire was multi-ethnic and multicultural. Local languages and religions and even self-government were allowed as long as people remained loyal to the empire and paid their taxes. In regions that were too poor to pay in money or in produce, the Ottomans often took a tax in the form of people. For example, young boys were taken as tribute captives from villages in the Balkans. They were converted from Christianity to Islam, educated, and then trained into an elite fighting force called the Janissaries, who reported directly to the emperor. Because they were personally loyal to one man, the Janissaries became politically very powerful. And actually, fear that this private army would betray him and name another heir to be the Sultan caused many new rulers to assassinate all their brothers as soon as they took the throne. And this kind of became the pattern in Ottoman politics. The Janissaries were the Ottomans' most effective weapon from 1363 to 1826, when the Sultan decided to disband them in favor of a modern military. Aside from muskets, the Janissaries had been very reluctant to adopt new military technology. They resisted this change and mutinied and marched on the Sultan's palace, but several thousand of them were wiped out by modern artillery, and then the survivors were rounded up and executed. The Ottoman Empire tried to modernize in other ways as well, but began falling behind its European neighbors in the 19th century and finally met its end in the First World War. And we'll return to that story in a few chapters. But now, before we continue, a couple of questions for discussion. Why did Istanbul rapidly become the largest city outside of China? And why was it dangerous for the Janissaries to report personally to the Sultan?